Hey guys, welcome back. In this lecture, we continue the discussion of functions to explore some more examples so you can understand how functions can be used in codeless logic. So far, we have learned that functions are reusable blocks of logic that you can continue invoking and reusing throughout your application. And we know that optionally a function may accept one or more arguments, or it could be a function without any arguments or input parameters, and the function may optionally return a value. Once we start learning objects, you will see how you can return more than one value, kind of packaged in one object, but I'm kind of getting a little bit ahead of the natural course of providing the information to you. So far, we're not going to be involving any objects at all. And let's create some examples, and you will see how I'm structuring the functions so you can see exactly what you could do in your applications. I will start with a simple function that converts Fahrenheit temperatures to Celsius. And that's going to be yet another example. So for this, I will create a function that I will call F2C. It's a very brief name. Normally, I would recommend expanding it to something bigger, but in the context of what we're doing, it's going to be fairly explanatory that this function will take temperature in Fahrenheit and convert it to Celsius. This function will accept one input parameter, and I will call this parameter ftemp or ftemperature. So this will be the value of temperature in Fahrenheit, and then inside of this function, we'll create the formula to convert Fahrenheit to Celsius. The formula is going to be rather simple. In fact, we can put the entire formula inside of the return value, because here we can just structure our formula. And the formula to convert from Fahrenheit to Celsius is rather simple. We need to subtract 32 and multiply the result of that subtraction by 5/9. And let's start doing that. So in math, we will take this value. So I will take the variable F temperature minus 32. That's the first part. Now we need to take the result of this and multiply by 5/9. So in order to do that, let's again use math. And this needs to be multiplied, first of all, by 5. And then this needs to be divided by 9. And for this, we again take this one, put this into here, and then divide this by 9. That's going to be our formula, and we can put it right into here. So this does all the conversions. And at this point, this function, we can start using it in our application. And for this, let's do the following. Print. And in math, we will take the number. Actually, we need to attach this number to actual function invocation. So this is our function invocation. And the number is going to be, how about 75, which is a very nice spring-like weather. So let's see what 75 in Fahrenheit is in Celsius. Let's run this. And we get 23.9 roughly, which is about, 24 degrees in Celsius. Let's do it a couple more times with other values. And then let's say if we take 32 Fahrenheit and see what it is in Celsius. And that is zero. So as you can see, our function is working. And the point of this demo was that you can just use the return value of your function to do everything. You may not need to necessarily put something into the body. Okay, let's consider some other example, which is not related to temperatures. And that example will be for calculating Fibonacci numbers. And if you're not familiar with Fibonacci, you can just Google Fibonacci numbers. You will get among the results this Wikipedia article, which goes to a great degree of describing all kinds of things related to Fibonacci sequence and where it is used. And you will find that there are plenty of examples of Fibonacci sequence in nature and architecture. It is really everywhere. But the point of this demo will be is that we will want to program this specific formula. So the sequence, Fibonacci sequence, goes like this, where the very first number in the sequence is zero, then the second, or it is zero based, and then the second number in the sequence is one, and then for all other numbers in the sequence, it is going to be the sum of the previous two numbers. So we will create a function that calculates the Fibonacci number for a specific number in the sequence, meaning that we actually will be able to produce these numbers. So if we were to pass 0, we'll get 0. If we pass 1, we'll get 1. If we pass 2, and so on. And then at some point, we will be getting these numbers back, because these are Fibonacci numbers that correspond to a specific position or number in the sequence. The reason for this is because I will be using an approach that is called recursion. And the recursion in programming is when a function actually calls itself, which is a very interesting concept, and it's going to be more of an advanced concept. But here the point will be is to demonstrate that you can call other functions or even itself from your function. Let's start programming this Fibonacci sequence calculation. I will create a new function. And in here, I will take the one that has the return value, and I will just call it fib. There's going to be one argument, and that argument I will call n. And the argument n will actually be the number, which is the position in the sequence for which I want to calculate this Fibonacci number. If you remember, for the position 0 and position 1, it returns, actually let me switch to this page. So for the position 0, it returns 0. For the position 1, it returns 1. Which basically means that for 0 and 1, it could return the actual position, because that's the number in the sequence. As you can see, it starts 0 and 1. And let's do that in our logic. And for this, if we add the if, and we can say that if n is less or equal 1, then just return n. And for this, let's go into logic, and we will drag the variable n, and we can say if it's less than or equal, and then that's going to be number 1. So what this does is that if n is less than, is basically is either 0 or 1, then what we want to do is we want to return actual n, because that's going to be the actual number in our Fibonacci sequence. And if we want to do a premature return, rather than waiting for this one, we can actually return right from our if condition. And inside of logic, you see that there is this return block. And we can use it right here in the middle, in the body of your function. And for this, if I drag my variable n, that's it. So this takes care of the special case. And the special case is this one. Now, for the rest, it is going to be the actual formula, okay? And then the formula is going to look like this. So we want to do the sum of the previous two numbers, Fibonacci numbers, in our sequence. And this is how we can implement it. So if we go to math, and in here, we can call our function with n minus 1. This is how we're going to do it. So let's go into functions, and here that's going to be fib, and the n is going to be this n minus 1, and for this we'll use math, take the variable n, and it's going to be minus 1. And for the second one, it is going to be variable n minus 2. And that's it. So it's very, very simple. Rather tricky, you're going to have to think about it, but let's just go over it one more time. So if n is going to be 0, let's just assume that this function cannot be called with negative values. That's just an assumption for the simplicity. Of course, we could add a condition and say that if n is negative, just do something that says, hey, you cannot invoke me. But let's just assume that n is going to be 0 or positive numbers. And then whenever we get n, it will be If it is less than or one, just return n. So we cover 0 and 1 positions. For everything else, let's say if n is 3, then this function will be called, we're calling itself, we basically say n minus 1. So the value that will be passed into Fibonacci is going to be 2. Okay, so n will be 2. Again, let's say we call this fib function with n equals 2. This check will not go through because 2 is greater than 1. And then we get into this again, where we basically say, invoke this fib with n being 2 minus 1. So we invoke fib where n really becomes 1. It becomes 1, boom, we get to this condition, we return n. So now we basically have this chaining effect. By invoking itself, we start bubbling up those values where eventually this function will return the actual value of the Fibonacci sequence for this n minus 1. And the same thing happens here for n minus 2. Let's see how well that works. So I will replicate print. Let's move these things out of the way. And let's invoke our function Fibonacci with n being, for instance, 5. And let's make it a little bit smaller. Let's comment these out by disabling them. So we have only one output, which is the Fibonacci sequence for position number 5. Let's run it. And we got 5. Let's check against this Wikipedia article. So this is going to be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And as you can see, we got the right number. Let's say it's going to be 6, 7, 8. So we will pass position 8, and the result should be 21. So let's change this to 8 and invoke it again. Boom. 21. So as you can see, this is working exactly as we anticipated. Again, this may be very simple example by looking at it, but it has quite a few new concepts, and it may be kind of hard to wrap your head around what's going on here. The important things that I wanted to highlight is that you can do premature return if you just need to return something out of the function, and the function itself, the function can call itself with whatever argument you need to. And in this case, the function calls itself twice for the previous number and for the number that goes right before the previous one. Very, very powerful stuff. I hope this cements your understanding of the functions as the concept. Even if you didn't understand the whole Fibonacci thing, that is okay. As long as you understood that you can do premature returns, and then the function can call other functions, even itself. That's what I wanted to get across in this video. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please leave a comment, ask your questions. Once we start getting into more visual stuff, specifically with UI Builder, we will be able to visualize a lot of things that are happening here. But right now, we're working on core codeless concepts. And now that we have covered functions, so many more other opportunities open up. So stick with me, and we'll definitely on the right path to go from zero to absolute master in codeless programming. Thanks again, guys, and as always, happy codeless coding.